feels like we was just getting ready to start Sunday school. I can't believe we're already at the last service. I appreciate again the opportunity to be here. Thank you for the meal. This afternoon we're going to preach on 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. We're just going to kind of cover the believer's position in grace. I have begun a study in 1 Corinthians, and as we get into this, you know, I think Paul lays out some pretty amazing things before he gets down to what I'll consider the meat of the problem here in Corinth with the church at Corinth. So 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 9, Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God, and Sosthenes, our brother, and unto the church of God which is at Corinth, to them which are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. Grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always on your behalf, for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by him, in all utterance, in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that as we open your word, we'll set everything aside, Lord, that what you'll have for us will come forth, Lord. Hide me behind the cross. Open our hearts to receive your word. Feed us from your text today. In Jesus' name, amen. The church at Corinth, as we're reading here, the church at Corinth, there's so much that could be said about it. And a lot of the things that could be said about the church at Corinth, you probably would not want to say. The church at Corinth was a wicked place. It was basically the sin center of the Roman Empire. It was a commercial city that had three different harbors inside of it. And while these three different harbors probably made people very wealthy in Corinth, it was a place where basically the east and west met. And so what it makes clear is that the vices of the west and the vices of the east basically met in the heart of Corinth and held hands. Corinth had a mixed population of Jews, Greeks, Italians. It was a real mixed multitude. It was estimated to have somewhere around 400,000 people in the population of Corinth during Paul's time. It was a sin-crazed culture. It was said that it was one of the biggest insults of that time to be called a Corinthian. If someone was to call you a Corinthian, it was to mean that you was living at the very limit of sin. To be called a Corinthian was to say that you was of the vile of vilest. It was to this environment that Paul would write this epistle. It was to this environment that Paul would open this epistle up. This epistle that we have today, that we're studying from today, 1 Corinthians, this is the second epistle that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth. He acknowledges that in 1 Corinthians 5:9. And 2 Corinthians would be the third epistle. This afternoon, I would just like to go through Paul's opening of the epistle and notice four points this afternoon. The calling of the church, the construction of the church, the character of the church, and the coming for his church. Verse 1, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. Is it not something this afternoon to be called? Paul says here in Corinthians, I am here today as a testament that God has called me. He believed that his standing as an apostle was only because he was called out of darkness into the marvelous light. And it was the will of God. In verse 9, Paul makes it even clearer. He takes it a step further, reminding them, listen, not all of you may have this Damascus Road experience that Paul had. Your experience in which you come to salvation may be different than the one that Paul is experiencing. But what Paul is trying to drive home, those who are saved, those who are called, those who are called to become members of his church, God has called you the same that God has called him. Verse 9, God is faithful by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The church here at Faith Missionary Baptist Church stands here for no other reason today than God called this church to exist. God called for you to be here. The calling that we experience in our life, meaning for those who are saved, God called you. The same calling you experienced in your life, though it may be different, the bottom line is that Paul's trying to drive home is this: God called you. Paul said, I am called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ, called to serve him in this facet. He tells him in verse 2, to them who are sanctified, called to be saints in Christ Jesus. Verse 9, God is faithful by whom ye are called. The question is this afternoon is that Paul said, I'm called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. But if we was to sit down today and we would say, you know what? I believe that God saved me. I believe that God called me out of darkness into this wondrous light. I believe that God called me. So then the question is this: if we was to do a caption maybe of the last month or the last year or the last 10 years of your life where you've been saved and walking with the Lord, you say called to be what? That's the question. Paul said, I'm called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. I've been called to be in the service. Saved to do what today are we? How long is it going to take for us, brothers and sisters, to get serious about getting into service for the Lord? Paul said, I'm called, saved, but I wasn't saved to do nothing. I've been saved, called out to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. See, brothers and sisters, this is one of the greatest problems that Corinth is going on in the church of Corinth. They had fallen prey to foolishness. They had fallen prey to the environment that they were in. They had fallen prey to the wickedness that that was going on there. And Paul would, listen, he would go on to confront this as the next 16 chapters would unfold. He would go on to confront the contention that was going on, the foolishness about who was saved and by who was baptized, who baptized them, who they was taking their identity in. Beloved, oftentimes, before we ever take too many steps forward into this world, it would be so good for us to stop for a minute and say, I am Danny Holt or Brother Keith Duncan or Brother Raymond Hood have been called out of this darkness into the wonderful light. God called you from that former life. This is not Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, so to say. You did not just wake up one day and say, you know what? I'll find the golden ticket and I'm going to cash it in today. No, God chose you. He chose you and he called you, not for stagnation, but for service. I'm glad that change came when he called us. That's what 1 Corinthians chapter 1 starts off. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Not Saul. He has a new name. He has a new call. He was now the apostle of Jesus Christ. Not Saul, the persecutor of the church. It was Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ. You're saved today. You have a new name. But today, what are we called to be? And he says, he goes on to say in verse 1, and Saulness, our brother. Paul could have strummed up, I'm sure, many accolades about Saulness. Paul could have said, I'm sure, that he had said, given Saulness many great names, many great titles, what he did for a living. But Paul thought the most important thing was to say about Saulness was this, is that he was our brother. It was not his wealth. It was not that he was funny. It was that he was our brother. What greater title could be given today than to say that you are my brother or that you are my sister in the Lord? In truth, In truth, if we could not call somebody our brother or our sister in the Lord, this means what? That they are not a child of God, which means that any other title that you could be given to them today is worthless in eternity. Oftentimes, you know, we have a military, right? And the military, the soldiers, they stick together in and out of battle. And they tell each other, you know, we're brothers, we're soldiers, we fight together, we have the same cause, we're called to serve, called to protect, and they love each other until the end, and they will fight until the bitter end. Paul says, this is softness, our brother. Oh, that we should see that our bond as a church, as churches, as brothers and sisters in the Lord should be much stronger than oftentimes it is. Warren Wiersbe once said, that great commentator said, the Christian life is not a playground, but a battleground. We are not at war with only sin, but with the evil of this day, with the prince and the power of the air. We are brothers and sisters in the Lord, bound together for the service in which we are called. We may say, well, you know, I don't feel that. I feel this way. I don't feel that, you know, about this is my brother or that he's my brother. Well, you know what? Paul would go on to even confront that and say, if we look at somebody and put some kind of a conditional love upon a brother or a sister in the Lord, it's not even agape love. That's phileo. That's unconditional love. Paul here in this opening to this to the church at Corinth is trying to remind them of the unconditional love, the unity that we have as brothers and sisters in the Lord. We are saved because God has called us to be saved, called us out of that, into this, saved, bonded together, saved not to be stagnant, saved for service, saved for work, saved to bear fruit. Notice also this, the construction of the church. Unto the church of God at Corinth, verse 2 says, every church in existence has two addresses. And guess what? Sometimes they both don't match up like they should. Every church has a geographical address in which it is located. But they also have an address in heaven. So what was the construction of this church at Corinth? Well, they were a group of believers called out from where? Called out from that wicked life in which they were living in. Called out of that filth. Sanctified in Christ Jesus. Those who were set apart, consecrated. They were set aside for what? Service. Why do I keep going back to that? Because this is what Paul is going to try to get across to the church at Corinth. That you guys have so much more to do than what you're involving yourselves in right now. Yeah, see, our physical bodies, they're no different from the world, right? We look the same as the world. You know what? We even have the same hearts as the world has. The only difference between our hearts and their hearts is that Jesus saved us. We're sanctified, set apart. Listen, in the days of the tabernacle, in the days of the temple, there were vases and cups. Just as there's vases and cups all around with the children of Israel. They all had vases and cups. But what made it so important is the vases, the cups, and the things that were used at the tabernacle were set apart for the use inside the tabernacle. They were set aside for the use of worship. They were set aside. They were holy, set apart. Yes, set apart. The world may say that, you know, we've gone insane, that we've tried to save ourselves, that we try to separate ourselves from the sin of this world so that we can be wholly devoted to the world, or to be wholly devoted to the Lord. The world will say, you know, we don't agree with this. What is wrong with you? You've gone insane. You're getting far too serious. But brothers and sisters, this is the same things they said about our Lord. Even his own brothers, it said, his own family thought that the Lord had gone insane. You know, the gospel, this Christian life that we have today, the gospel that we're called today, it has been, what we'll say, by many Christians, tried and rejected. They don't like it. They don't want to be that serious. They want the reward of Jesus saving them, but they don't want to labor. In the end of verse 2, he says, with all that in every place that call upon the name of the Lord. Paul's hope is to reach them all to clarify the things that are coming up. Verse 3, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father, from the Lord Jesus Christ. Several things for us to see here. Paul takes a wide sweep here. First, notice the order. You will never find the peace of God until you experience the grace of God. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So peace always comes, or grace, you will never find the peace of God until you experience the grace of God. Secondly, notice Paul's arrangement in the greeting. This grace is the word that the Greeks would use to greet each other in that day. The Greek word being charis. And peace is the word in which Jews would use to say greetings to each other or hello. Matter of fact, many Jews today in culture still open each other and still greet each other by saying shalom. Thirdly, I think that all this matters because Paul has already made it clear that he is addressing the church at Corinth. He is making it clear that I am talking to the church at Corinth, and I'm using both of these words. I'm using the Greek greeting and the Hebrew meaning. Because why? Because here at the church, it should be united. There's no division in the church. If there was any a place to this world should be able to experience the grace and peace of God that has affected the saints, it should be here at the church. If there was ever a place that the world should experience the love of God, it's right here. If there was ever a place that should not ever be divided or segregated, it's the church. Well, what makes you say that? Well, because Paul is greeting both the Jews and the Greeks right here. He just, after he said this, being to the church of Corinth, all those who were called to be saints. Now he says, the grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. You know why the world ain't offering much grace and peace in this day and age? Because they don't know the author of grace and peace. Verse 3 gives that to us. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father. From God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. They don't know the author of grace and peace. They don't know the one in which gives it to us. Had the world known where to experience grace and peace, the world would be very different today, I believe. But this is why we're called to preach the gospel. Preach the gospel is oftentimes a great reminder for us to how wicked and depraved we were. I fear that oftentimes, you know, after we get saved, we kind of get high and mighty, so to say, and look down on the world, and we forget what we were. We forget, as the Bible says, and such were some of you. We forget what happened in our life and what caused us to be different. We forget that Jesus saved us from our sins. We forget that we had an encounter with the living God, and that is what changed our walk. We sure didn't change this on our own. That's why he says in verse 4, I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ. Given you. Everything that you experience today, everything that you have today in Christ, you did not earn it. Everything that you experience on this in this salvation, he bought it on Calvary. Everything we experience today is a blessing from God. Notice lastly the character of the church at Corinth, verse 5. So Paul reminds them here that in everything ye are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. In all utterance and all knowledge that you be rooted. Verse 6. As the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. Verse 7, so that ye come in behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of the Lord. So getting back up to verse 7, because the grace of God in your life that you have experienced, some enrichments and some spiritual gifts, Paul is taking a minute to acknowledge the spiritual gifts that the rest of this epistle, Paul is going to be ironing out some things to the church of Corinth. But he wants to take a minute to acknowledge that the church of Corinth has some spiritual gifts, some in utterance, some in knowledge, some in many different facets that we don't even know. But all these things that this church is experiencing, Paul is taking a minute saying, listen, the Holy Ghost, the Lord is working among you. You guys are enriched in many spiritual gifts. Matter of fact, if you was to stop at verses 9 in this opening to the church of Corinth, you would say, wow, the church at Corinth is one gifted group. Paul is saying that you're one of the gifted, most gifted churches around. One commentator said this. It's true. The church at Corinth was probably one of the most gifted churches in the New Testament, but they were also one of the most carnal churches in the New Testament. Hear me now. We stop here, and if we neglect the next 16 chapters, you would think this is great. But Paul takes the rest of the next 16 chapters to hammer out something, and that is this: character matters. You can be a gifted group. You can be one of the greatest singers of all time. You can be one of the greatest preachers of all time. You can really wow people. You could have a following. You could have 100,000 followers on Facebook. But what Paul is trying to get here to the church at Corinth is this. It's like, yes, you guys are a really gifted group. Yes, you have many enrichments from the Lord. But let me tell you something. You guys are carnal Christians. There's something wrong. Character matters. This is what he's after. Don't make someone your hero just because they can preach a good sermon. Don't make someone your hero just because they can sing a good song. Don't idolize someone when you don't know. If we was to stop at the first 9 verses, we may say, man, if I could go back to the New Testament, I would want to be at the church of Corinth because they're a really gifted work. But Paul's saying, no, this character matters. That's why we go on the next 16 chapters. When we look to people in this world, when we look at our own Christian lives, we need to ask ourselves, not did I get up and sing a good song? Not did I play the piano? Not did I do this? Not did I do that? The question is, are we faithful to the work in which we are called? Faithful to the Lord. Brothers and sisters, character matters. Verses 7 through 9. So that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, waiting for the coming of our Lord. Oh, Paul loved that Christ came to this earth. Paul loved that Christ came here and died on the cross for us. He hated that Christ did it, but he loved it because it changed his life. But he longed for God. He longed for Jesus to come again in all his glory and honor. He longed to see his Savior first of all. Verses 8 says, who shall confirm you? This is a great blessing that what? That he will confirm you. You cannot confirm yourself. You have no divine power to confirm yourself, but he will confirm you when he comes. You could not keep yourself saved even if you wanted to, but Christ in his divine power will preserve us in the very state of grace until the very end. This salvation that we have experienced is secure in him by his power until the very end. What a wonderful guarantee. And because of the glorious work of our Lord Jesus Christ, verse 8 says, that ye may be blameless in that day of our Lord Jesus Christ. The purity that we have will be secured in the Lord. Once saved, always saved, once made pure, and will always remain pure. You know why verse 9 lets us know that? Why is it so? Because God is faithful. Hear me. The reason that we remain safe, secure, pure before God the Father is because we have been made secure. Even on our days when we are not faithful to God, he is faithful to us. Not one of us will ever be plucked out of the Lord's hand. Not one of us will ever be lost. Not one of us will ever be removed. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And that's all I have for you this morning, this afternoon. But what I want to recap is this. Paul goes on for the next 16 chapters talking about the wickedness that is in the church. There was many issues that was going on in the church at Corinth. But in the beginning, Paul wanted them to know this. He wanted them to focus in that, listen, in this church, the importance of the church is that, brothers and sisters, we are called by God for service to him. More than service, even if we can do something, one good gift, one good thing that we do for the Lord, if we have wicked character outside of it, it's wrong. It matters. The Lord doesn't like it. All that He did is confirmed us, preserved us in this purity because of the atoning work of Jesus on the cross. And it will keep us pure until the end. May we always remember this in service to the Lord. Character matters. This world should not get conflicting messages. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, I thank You for this opportunity here, Lord, in opening up Your word and gleaning from it. May we be challenged to be in service for You, Lord. May we always search our hearts, Lord, to see if we have the right heart about what we're doing for You in service. Oh God, I thank You for all that You've done. Continue to work at this church. Continue to bless the pastor as he feeds the church here, Lord, that he remains faithful to You. I know what a blessing he's been to me, Lord. Thank You for this church and the love they showed to my family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Appreciate that.